So we had extreme events. So here we are talking about stone-induced hazard. So this is, we lost the lowest part of the presentation here. But this is a storm that took place in October 2003. So this is a cyclone in the Mediterranean, very close to the Catalan coast. This is the Catalan coast. When we talk about extreme events, storm impacts in the Catalan coast, we are referring to a coastal storm and a storm in the coast. Coastal storm means that we have two essentially two main hazards, inundation and erosion. And when we talk about a storm in the coast, we are referring that the storm is in the hinterland and it is producing a specific hazard, that this is typical for the Mediterranean coast, that are the flash flood. So then we are trying to identify hotspots related to these three hazards, a storm in the coastal storm and a storm in the coast. Coastal storm. So this is an example. This is our study site. That this is the Tordera Delta. This is a storm that took place in December 2008. And here we can see what we are trying to look for, inundation and erosion. So which are the elements that we are including in our tool in order to say that this is objective? So we are putting a lot of data. How do we represent the coast in order to identify the hotspot? So we are taking sector of 1 kilometer each. In each sector, so we are taking one profile every 200 meters. And for each profile, so we are obtaining a lot of information in order to obtain which is the magnitude of the hazard. So we are using information about the profile topography, beach face slope, beach width, and grain size. The information is being obtained from the most updated source of information. In our case, we are using LiDAR data, we are using aerial photograph, and we are also using field data. So this, all these data are going to be used in order to fit our tool. How do we represent the forcing? So now, this is the code that is receiving the impact. So for the forcing, so we are using wave and water level data. In this case, because we want to use the probabilistic approach, so we need long-term series. So then we are using previous results from previous EU-funded projects, like the HypoCast project. In the HypoCast project, so they did a hindcast analysis for the wave and water level conditions in all the European coasts. So then we are using here a database with wave and water level data for 44 years. So now we have a relative long-term series that will be used in order to characterize our storm impact. So in our case, the storm is defined like an event where the significant wave height is exceeding a threshold of 2.5 meters during a minimum period of 6 hours. With this, for this time series, so we have about 120 storms in order to be analyzed to produce this probability distribution of hazard. This is the data that we are using. So the tool is good, provided that you have good data. Otherwise, the tool will not be longer useful. So then we need to use the best data as possible. So the way forward, so we need to evaluate some indicator of hazard, some indicator for exposure, and then to obtain some coastal risk index. And at the end, we identify the hotspot. This is the procedure that Chris showed before. Inundation hazard. So for inundation hazard, for coastal storm, so we have to obtain the extreme probability distribution of the total water level at the shoreline. So we have two components. So we have a component that is the storm surge, and we have the components induced by the water level induced by the wave action. In the Mediterranean, the most important part is the wave run up, not the storm surge. It's very different to the North Sea. In the North Sea, during a storm, you can have a storm surge up to 5 meters. In the Mediterranean, during extreme storm, so we have a storm surge of 50 centimeters. It's nothing in comparison with the wave run up. So if we have a reflected beach with a coarse sediment, so the wave run up can go up to 4 meters during a extreme storm. So then we have two components, being wave run up the most important. And this is crucial for the Catalan case. So when we are going to do inundation modeling, it's different from what we are doing in the normal sea. Because now we have a water level that this is not permanent during the storm. It is just a fluctuating water level associated to the wave action. So then, more than talking about inundation, we are talking just about overwash close to the shoreline. So then we are not dealing with too much extension of the inundation, but a buffer, a coastal buffer very close to the shoreline. So then at the end, what we obtain is something like this. Here it is return period. You cannot see, you have to trust on me. Here it is return period. And this is elevation, total water level at the shoreline. So then I can select, or the end user will select, which is the return period for the analysis, and then we can get which is the associated water level. Of course, this is done for each profile along the coast, for each sector. So that in some cases, if the profile are the same, we'll have the same distribution for different sector. But if the profile is different, we have a different probability distribution for each sector along the coast. With this, we go profile per profile, and we identify which part of the profile will be inundated, will be subjected to inundation associated to runoff and to water level for a given probability. And then we obtain which is the extension of this area. Of course, this is not the same that we are dealing with a huge inundation. And then we have created a scale of the hazard that, again, it is disappearing the lowest part of the presentation. And the scale goes from 0 to 5. And then depending on the width of the beach that this is going to be flooded, we associate a given index from 0 to 5. 5 is the maximum impact, 0 is no impact, or no hazard. This is the distribution of the hazard for two probabilities, for a return period of 50 years, for a return period of 100 years along the Catalonian coast. Each point, it is representing a segment of 1 kilometer. And here you can see the scale from 0, that this is essentially, that this is not going to be significantly inundated, to 5, where the segment will be inundated up to a buffer relatively large. So then we have a distribution along the coast for different points at a different scale. Of course, here we can identify some point with a higher hazard than the other one, but this is just coastal hotspot in hazard terms, not in risks. Erosion. Erosion will be the same. So now the difference is that now we are going to, at the same time that we have inundation, the impact of the storm will also induce erosion. This is something that has not been included in the implementation of the flood directive. The flood directive just dealing with inundation. But during the storm, in a sandy beach, there will be also erosion. So then the erosion will enhance the flooding. So if we want to assess the risk associated with the stream bed, we have to consider both. So here, again, we are going to obtain for the different sector, which is the impact or the magnitude of the hazard associated to a given probability. Here, we are going to obtain which is the erosion volume and also the shoreline retreat. So at the end, we're going to obtain something like this and then to associate again a hazard category to each magnitude. So then, depending if the beach is fully eroded, if the remaining beach width is something, so then we associate a given hazard scale for the beach. So at the end, if we apply to the same area for the same probability, 50 and 100, so we have a different distribution of the hazard. Depending. Now we are accounting just the magnitude of the erosion. Before was the magnitude of flooding. So now we want to include exposure in order to combine hazard with exposure to obtain something related to risk. These are the 5 categories that we are including: land use, population, transport, utilities, and business. So for our coast, we obtain also the data and we include, or we obtain for the different land use along the Catalan coast, we use also a category for each land use in terms of importance for land use. The same for transport systems. So here we have the coast, so we have the coastal railway, we have a coastal road very close to the shoreline, and in a buffer very close to the shoreline, we analyze the 5 different items. At the end, we have for the same sector a distribution of the exposure. So now we can combine both inundation and erosion with exposure. And here you have the result. So here we have the coastal flooding risk index along the coast for the 2 different probabilities.